coming up on Need to Know. The number of babies in the city of Rochester that don't make it to their first birthday is beyond alarming. Our community's high infant mortality rate is the focus of a new documentary series on PBS. We'll examine the story behind the numbers. Also on the show, two local women have joined forces to track down Korean War veterans or their families. The reason? To reunite them with original wartime photographs and recall memories from what's often called the Forgotten War. And a Rochester area veteran and artist paints with a purpose, how he's using his talents to better serve veterans and their needs. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. In the U.S., about 24,000 babies die each year before their first birthday. The death of a child under the age of one is called infant mortality. According to the Centers for Disease Control, the infant mortality rate in the United States is higher than any of the other 27 wealthy countries around the globe. And if you dig in a bit more and examine Rochester on its own, you'll see its infant mortality rate rivals those of third world countries. Dig in even more, and you'll see that the disparities along racial and economic lines when it comes to infant mortality are significant. The issue is the focus of an upcoming program for the documentary series America by the Numbers with Maria Hinojosa, airing on PBS. And here's a preview of that program.
Infant mortality is defined as the death of a live-born infant before his or her first birthday.
The U.S. ranks 56th in infant mortality rates worldwide, worse than most industrialized countries. But for babies born to moms of color, the rates are even higher.
I was stunned when I learned about the infant mortality racial disparities in Rochester.
In Rochester, New York, Black and Latino babies die at three times the rate of white babies.
Stress unchecked without support can be toxic. It can impact the health of a woman and the baby.
So are you saying that there were some times
where I didn't eat to feed my kids? Yes.
My name's Yolanda. My name and number's on the bottom. Rochester is taking a stand so that mom can have the best, healthiest pregnancy that she can have.
To examine the issue of infant mortality in Rochester and what's being done to change the dismal statistics in our community, I'm joined by award-winning journalist Maria Hinojosa and Dr. Jeff Kaczorowski, president of the Children's Agenda here in Rochester. And it's an honor to have both of you on the program. Thank you for being here.
It's great
to be here.
So we know the numbers. We heard some of them in the preview, and they are heartbreaking and they are horrific. And you break the numbers down even more by race. And Maria, this is something you did recently for Latino USA. That was on NPR. African-American and Latino babies in Rochester die at three or four times the rate of white babies. And I want to know, beyond exploring the numbers, talk to me about your goal in coming to Rochester to further investigate this story, because you called Rochester the ground zero for the infant mortality story, and I want to know why.
So, you know, I love to do stories that are untold stories. I love to be able to do stories that a lot of people don't want to do, because frankly, talking about infant mortality in our country, who wants to talk about that? It's horrible. When we started peeling back the numbers, because the series, America by the Numbers, is all about the data. So we saw high infant mortality rates among African-American women in the South. This has been a decades-long problem. But when we peeled it back a little bit more and we started to look at the numbers in Rochester, and we found out that in Rochester, in one of the cemeteries, there is a section that is just devoted for infants who don't make it to their first birthday, it was like, well, we have to go here. We have to come here. And in my mind, I said, I want to know, I want to see the faces of the women in our country who have lost their babies because of no fault of their own. And that's what ended up bringing us here to Rochester. I really wanted to put a human face on the story, and we wanted to make it surprising. Everyone that we talked to, when we say we went to Rochester, where infant mortality among Black and Latino women is so high, everybody just says, what? Rochester? And that's when we peel it back and we're like, yes, huge problem of, you know, of divided city in many ways.
And let's talk about that, because I can tell you, in terms of the leading causes, there are a handful of causes for infant mortality. We've got birth defects, preterm births, and sudden infant deaths, known as SIDS. And I know we've got viewers, and they're watching at home right now, and they're thinking, my gosh, how is this happening right now in Rochester? You just alluded to this. And how are there greater implications for Latino and African American babies? And Dr. Kaczorowski, you have served as a pediatrician. What would you say to them?
I think Rochester provides a striking illustration about the problem of infant mortality in the United States. And let's face it, the United States is not doing very well. 56th in the world. I mean, imagine that. The wealthiest country in the history of the world, and our infant mortality rate, the number of babies dying, is 56th. But Rochester provides a striking illustration of this because of the way our community is divided by economy and by race. And so it is, in many ways, a perfect illustration of the disparities that exist around this issue. Hélène, what drives infant mortality in the United States, what drives this striking difference that we have, is premature births. It is the main driver of infant mortality in the United States, and it's the main reason why we're different than other countries. And in the film, there's a beautiful and very compassionate interaction that Maria has with a mom who has lost her baby, who was born prematurely, and then goes on subsequently to have a healthy, beautiful baby boy because we changed our approach and offered her help and support in a way that wasn't available to her in that first pregnancy.
I want to look at the economic line. And for years, there's been this connection between poverty and infant mortality. And I want to know specifically, so viewers get an understanding of this, how can that connection be made? What does it look like when you say that there's this link between the two?
You know, when Sasha in our piece says, and we saw it at the top of the show, when she says, there were times when I didn't eat so that my child could eat. She was pregnant at the time when she wasn't eating. Because I had asked her precisely, so I want to understand what toxic stress looks like. What does it look like? She was like, well, you know, sometimes I wasn't eating. Very bad for a pregnant woman not to be eating. Yeah. Toxic stress, I think also, this piece actually changed my life and the way I approach stress because I'm under a tremendous amount of stress. But there will be a time when I can just say, okay, but I can pay my bills this month. Or my child is safe. I'm not worried that my daughter's gonna get shot. So I have periods in my life where I can lower my stress level. I run, I exercise because I'm aware of this. If you're a mom in a poor, abandoned community where there is violence, gunfights, fear all the time, fear about money, making ends meet, not getting a job, you know, just talking about it, I'm starting to get a little. Now imagine if that never stops. It's clear that that can have an impact in what's happening with your pregnancy.
And that word toxic stress was brand new to me. I'd never heard of that term before, and I heard it for the first time in your NPR piece. And toxic stress, how that's, I think, a term new to many people. How does that stress, in terms of differing from everyday stress that you mentioned, then tie into infant mortality?
Sure. Yeah, let's talk about that a little bit. So toxic stress is exactly what Maria described. It is that you have constant, unremitting stress. And the other part of it that's really important is that you don't have any supports. Mm-hmm. You don't have the ability to deal with that or develop resilience because there's the feeling that you're abandoned, that your community is not helping you, that you're alone in your struggles. And these are very significant struggles, as Maria described. We know now, it is really well established that this toxic stress has impact on the health of kids for their entire lives. And in terms of this issue of infant mortality and going back to the driver of that being prematurity, it is really clear that toxic stress plays a role in prematurity, the main driver of infant mortality. And so in the United States, we have these incredible disparities. Rochester is an illustration of that. Mm-hmm. And that is driving and what makes it so difficult to get our arms around, our hands around this issue of infant mortality, because it's being driven by these environmental concerns that are very big and very problematic for many families.
And basically, I mean, what was amazing to me is that it's invisible, right? I mean, when we were filming, and I had just left Sasha, and then we literally are less than 5 minutes away from, you know, downtown, from hospitals. Mm-hmm. I just flew in today. You know, the first thing you see when you fly into Rochester, to the Frederick Douglass International Airport, one of my favorite airports of all time, because I love Frederick Douglass, but you see all the ads, you know, Rochester, health, you know, number one, get your treatment for cancer, for this, and it's just like, and in this city, babies are dying at a higher rate than in others in our country? How is this possible?
And there are, and you met foot soldiers on the ground working to talk with women in at-risk, high-poverty areas to say to them, listen, these are some of your options in terms of perinatal care. But in terms of capacity, there's just not enough to meet the needs. Is that correct?
Yeah, so it is both that we need excellent medical care, and we need to think about health differently and realize that you don't get health by going to the doctor's office, that health is what surrounds us every day. So with this issue of prematurity, our hospital and hospitals in the United States, I work in the interest of full disclosure at the University of Rochester Medical Center at the Golisano Children's Hospital as well. We do a great job of caring for premature babies. The issue is there are so many, and some of them can't be saved. Mm. So we do a better job in the United States of saving premature babies than almost anywhere, but we have so many more premature babies, and it's because of the environment that women and children are subject to. Does that make sense?
It does. Dr. Jeff Kaczorowski and award-winning journalist Maria Hinojosa, I'm grateful for your time today and for your insight. And to learn more about the work of the Children's Agenda in connection to Rochester's infant mortality, go to thechildrensagenda.org. And you do not want to miss America by the Numbers with Maria Hinojosa, Surviving Year One. The program airs this Saturday night, November 15th at 6:30, right here on WXXI-TV. Imagine receiving more than 100 original photographs from a war you served in. Photographs of men and women in uniform containing captions with information such as names, ranks, hometowns, and branch of service. Well, that's exactly what happened to Korean War veteran Betty Perkins Carpenter. The images are from the Korean War, which lasted from 1950 to 1953. But Perkins Carpenter doesn't want to hang on to these historic photographs. She wants to give them all away to the men and women pictured in the photos or their families. To learn all about her mission, we're joined by Betty Perkins Carpenter herself and Tiana Stevens, her partner in this project and the granddaughter of a Korean War veteran. And thank you both for being here.
You're welcome.
So, Betty, I understand there is quite an interesting backstory in terms of how you got your hands on these photographs. And I hear that they were found in the basement of a fellow Korean War veteran. He used to work for the Batavia Daily News. So how did he get them, and how were they given to you?
Actually, it was his wife. He's deceased now, and his wife found these in the basement. So she gave them to the commander, Roger Hill, of our Korean War post. And Roger looked at them, and he just gave them to me, and he said, Betty, I think you'd like to look at these. So when I looked at them, it was like, I got to get these to the families, because I know how many men didn't come home. And if you get a picture of a father that you never knew, or it gets to a grandmother, as in Tiana's case, which is so exciting. And so I just got to find them, and sort of it just become a mission.
So you see these photographs, they're mostly taken from the summer of 1950, the first few months of the Korean War. Where were you during that time?
In basic training.
Okay.
I think just out of basic training at Lackland Air Force Base. Oh. So I wasn't over there. My job in the Air Force was to train our crews in water survival. And because I had been a diving champion, they had to go off a 10-meter tower. And so I was used to it, and I was just a sergeant, and I walked by them, they were all officers. And so you could tell by body language that it's just gonna be a piece of cake. So I just walked by them, went up and jumped in. And then when I came up, it was, yes, ma'am. Everybody was at attention.
What's interesting, when you received these photographs, and Tiana, I understand you heard about them through the local news, and you're right. sitting at home, right. you're watching this story on television, and as fate would have it, an image pops up on the screen that you actually recognize, and tell us about right. that experience.
So it was about 2 years ago, and first of all, the story was just fascinating, and the pictures that came across the screen were just beautiful, not your normal wartime photos that you would see, but just men and women, soldiers doing kind of everyday things. And so one photo in particular caught my eye because I said, well, that looks like my grandfather. And then I started to think of it and, you know, well, how could that be? That would be too much of a coincidence. And so I kind of put it in the back of my mind.
And we've got this photo up right now yes. so people can see it. And he's a gentleman in the middle.
He's right in the
middle.
Holding
the cup.
Yeah, he's actually holding a bottle of pop. And so he's pouring it out. And if you read the back of the photo, because they all have captions mm-hmm. on it, it says, it's August 9th, 1950. Soldiers during a break in the battle enjoying their first drink of soda pop. So he's the one that's in the center pouring it out. It was just a remarkable find. But I waited. I actually waited about a year to contact Betty just because I really convinced myself that there's no way that this coincidence would happen like that. So I was looking through my own photos, like I said, a year later, and I came across a photo that's actually a mirror image of this photo. Wow. And I said, I should probably contact this Betty Perkins Carpenter and just see the photo for myself, see it in person so I can cross it off the list if it's not him. And if it right. is, you know, what's next after that? So
and it was a match.
It was a match.
It was a match.
Yeah.
It was a match.
And not only was it a match, after this match is made, the two of you actually partner up on this project. And I understand yeah. you, Tiana, had some ideas of your own to make this a success because you've got over 100 photographs. How right. will the world see them? And I right. think you said they've got to go up online.
Right. So after Betty gave me the photograph and I took it home to Denver to my family and all these stories came out that wow. my grandfather's yeah. deceased that I hadn't heard about him before, and he never talked about the war like many veterans. They don't want to talk about it. And so having this picture in front of my grandmother, all these wonderful stories came out, and I knew we have to make this happen for the rest of the people in the photos, and there's so many recognizable faces in there. So I contacted Kodak Alaris, who I knew had the technology to scan quickly right. and safely, because these are delicate, right. Important photographs. And I couldn't imagine someone scanning them by hand and just the chance of tearing them or damaging right. them in some way. So they volunteered to scan all of the photos for us, and they actually have technology that can scan both the front and back at the same time, because again, the captions are so important, dates and names and hometowns.
Exactly. And then the Democrat and Chronicle creates the website, and all yes. the photographs are up, snapshots of the Korean War.
Yeah.
And Betty, I have to ask, the story made national attention, Military Times, Navy Times, other national
Air
news
Force
sites.
Magazine.
Air Force Magazine. Tell me about the journey so far, because the project went online this past summer. What has it been like making connections, and you've got one match here. How successful have you been?
Every match, 10 of them, is a story unto itself. And Tiana's grandfather, as she said, is here in the middle. Then I get a call from the lady, that's her father, who her grandfather is pouring the pop into his cup. So we find a father and a grandfather in one picture. And when you saw the two of them, they met in my house, it was like, and I get goosebumps. I mean, it's just, oh my gosh, they were just like, it's your grandfather, it's your father. And then I'll never forget, Joanne says to her, ooh, it's emotional. I think your father and my grandfather are talking about us right now, looking down and talking about the war. I mean, that's the power that these pictures have on a family. Tiana showed it to her grandmother, took it, now her grandmother gets a picture of her husband. And then one is a POW. That's so heartrending too, because I sent him his picture, and he emails me and he said, I'm the author of a book, 1,000 Days of Torture. Mm-hmm. So, and he hand wrote with fingers that hardly worked too well. He wrote me a 3-page legal size handwritten letter about his time in Korea. So every one is a story. I mean, some of the stories are really funny, and some of them are just so emotional. They tug at your heartstrings. Yeah. And I can't thank the Democrat and Chronicle enough for doing this. I mean,
I have to imagine that also time is of the essence for you and connecting these images.
Because we're in our 80s, and I want to get these to the families. A lot of these men are still living, and a lot aren't, but what a treasure for someone's brother, sister. Oh, one's mail call. This is really, really funny. They're all backs of heads, right? And there's a, when mail call is really big in the military. So there's a man giving out the mail, and I get a call from Holly. She said, and it's back of the head, she said, "That's my father, second from the bottom." I said, "Holly, how do you know?" She said, "I got a call from my uncle, Uncle George."
My goodness.
He said, "That's your father. I was there. He's in the picture over here. Out of sight. So, I mean, it's just unbelievable.
And these are the stories that you hope to rekindle these memories of the forgotten war.
Yes.
And to bring these memories back. You could have sent these pictures to a museum or to a college or a university, but you chose to connect them with the families and the veterans themselves.
Yeah. Right.
Thank you so much. Tiana Stevens and Betty Perkins Carpenter, I thank you for your time today. And be sure to check out the website, Snapshots from the Korean War. Go to koreanwar.democratandchronicle.com. Helping our community recognize soldiers as everyday people who can do some pretty amazing things. That's the goal of Sergeant Ryan Kennedy. He's an Afghanistan war veteran who currently serves in the New York Army National Guard, but that's not his only job. He's also an artist and the owner of Iron Art. It's a graphic design and marketing company he launched after returning to Rochester. Kennedy got the artistic bug as a young boy, and his talent for painting has only grown throughout the years. It even played a key role during his deployment. And now he produces fine art in an effort to benefit veterans. Brian Kennedy joins us now to share more about his work. And it's great to have you here.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
You were bitten by the artistic bug as a child. And I have to know, did you ever imagine that your artistic talents would serve you well overseas, in the military, in Afghanistan, of all places?
I could not imagine. It came across when we were in California training in the Mojave Desert. And our company was looking for someone to paint a rock, and they had this huge stone quarry of rocks. And everyone who got deployed would send someone there to paint one of these rocks to represent their company. And these rocks there's like a mile or two full of just different rocks, and they all represent the different companies and different battalions and such that got deployed to war zones. So I was chosen to paint the rock for 2nd 108th Infantry Battalion, and it was really cool. But my friend Jason Ulig was he's a second lieutenant, and he asked me to, or he came across my artwork, and he knew that I could draw, and he showed it to the battalion commander and the XO. And the next thing you know, they're asking me to create artwork for the battalion. And so I started working with translators and such that spoke different languages, and we were creating artwork that could be used to catch terrorists who were blowing up mosques and shutting down hospitals and such. And it was pretty wild.
My God.
And so when we got to Afghanistan, it was really different because I had never been to a war zone. And I was really scared. And so, I mean, anyone who says they're not scared would be lying. But so I started creating all this artwork for the battalion, and I started doing drawings of the battalion commanders and the XOs and just pretty much every soldier that I could come across. And then at nighttime, because I couldn't sleep sometimes, I had this assault bag, and it would usually be full of ammo, but I took all the ammo out, and I stowed it, or I started putting art supplies that were being sent from home, like paintbrushes.
So you had friends and family from back home sending you
these
supplies.
They knew I liked to draw, so. So I started filling this backpack full of art supplies, and then I would go out, and at nighttime, I would had this flashlight on the top of my head, and I started painting these murals on the walls and of local things like dinosaur barbecue, but I would give it a military spin, you know? So instead of the dinosaur barbecue, dinosaur holding a plate of food, he's holding like an M16 and he's got combat boots on and a Kevlar helmet. So
you do this, A, for one, you can't sleep, but I'm sure also for morale and for your fellow soldiers.
Yes, it helped me get rest and helped me keep me positive, but also just seeing these guys who were coming back from these missions, and they were coming back, and you know they were extremely tired. You know, sometimes we're working 12 to 16 hour shifts, and seeing these guys come back, and before, you know, they're like about to go in their bunk, and they see this mural painted on the wall that wasn't there the day before, and just to see them be like, they were just amazed by it, you know, and they would stop and take a look at it.
I want to ask you, you come back to Rochester, and you continue to carry on this craft and this talent, but this time you're doing it for a specific purpose, and I want to know a little bit about that. Why the decision to really focus in on painting and to start this company when you return?
Well, when I first came back, I really struggled with the idea of how some people survived and some people didn't. Some soldiers came back, some soldiers didn't. And I really couldn't understand that. And then I realized that, how do I say, I felt like those people who didn't make it back would want me to do something fulfilling with my life and use my creative abilities to kind of to draw attention to what veterans do. And so it just seemed like the right thing to do, to start creating artwork to help veterans and do what I love the most, you know.
And you actually volunteered to paint, it was called the Wall of Honor for the Veterans Memorial, Veterans Outreach Center, and we've got footage of that. And you have portraits of veterans, and this is a tribute to veterans living in Rochester. And I want to know, why portraits in particular, and how did you go about selecting the veterans that are on the wall?
Well, I sent a message out on Facebook and to all my friends and family, and to all these people, anyone who was affiliated with veterans, to say, if you know someone who's serving or who has served in the past, please just send me an email and drop an email to my email address, and I'll make sure that I put them up on the wall. Because, man, it was just a really good thing to do, you know? How could I give back? And this is perfect. And I was really scared at first about, like, the size and scale of this wall and like messing it up and making sure that like everything looked right. But then I realized something that was more important. I realized that the message that the wall was going to create was far more important than my fear of creating this and messing up. And so the message was more important. And so that's why I feel comfortable doing it. And it just comes naturally to me.
We've got about a little less than a minute left. In terms of the response you want from this mural, in particular from fellow veterans, what do you want that to be?
I want to pay respect to those who served in the past and who are serving currently, and to show that that military personnel are creative, intuitive people who can think outside the box, that we don't just take orders, and that we can do things that we're normal people who do extraordinary things.
Sergeant Brian Kennedy, doing extraordinary things. Thank you for your time and for joining me today. I appreciate it. You can check out the progress of the Wall of Honor for yourself. It's located at 290 Cypress Street, just off South Avenue. And you can learn more about Brian Kennedy and his latest work on his website, ironart315.com. And that is it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Hélène Biandudi Hofer. Thanks for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend. And thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI. I'll see you next week.